Good morning and God bless you. We're delighted to have you with us here this morning. Perhaps you're visiting for the first time. We want to say that we are glad that you are with us and trust that you are blessed with what you hear today. I want to start with prayer. I want to pray for our president and our nation. We also want to pray for our local community here. And we want to continue to pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church and our brothers and sisters among us. Some have very special needs. Perhaps you have a special request. This is a perfect time to make that known unto God. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for the abundance of all things. Father, we pray for our president. We pray for our nation. We pray, oh God, that you will navigate our president through these challenging and difficult times. Father, also we pray for our local community that you will continue to open up doors of utterance that we can communicate and witness to our community. And then we want to pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church and our brothers and sisters, some of which have some very extreme needs. Father, I pray that you'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out your virtue, your strength, and your protection. We ask this all in the name above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said amen. Praise God. I want to draw your attention to one verse of scripture found here in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse number 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart. I want to read that again. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart. I've really had this on my heart and in my mind for the last little while. And I really felt this morning that it was time to ask this question. And the question that I want to pose this morning in this devotional is, where are they now? Where are they now? And I think that what's happening with this pandemic over the course of the last 4.5 months, it has been an education in and of itself. Because of the unique pressures and sets of circumstances with incredible inconveniences that have been placed upon the body of Christ, not just here in Spokane, Washington, but wherever you are, that there's been a level of pressure that has been applied to the body of Christ that heretofore has never been experienced in people's lives. There's probably some among us that are elders that can even remember going back 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years ago that still remember certain hardships here in America, culturally and socially. And they lived for God faithfully through those times. Most notably, even people that lived and survived through the Depression have been telling me that what we're experiencing today is more severe in its impact and its encumbrances than what people even experienced during the Depression time. But the Bible says that the Spirit here was giving prophetical insight that in the latter times, in the end times, at the times of the end, some shall depart. Some shall depart. You know, over the last 26 years in pastoring here in Spokane, Washington, there's a lot of things that I have seen. And one of the things that no pastor relishes and no pastor looks forward to is the reality that some people just give up. They just give out just in a moment of weakness. Whatever the situation is, and it would take us the remainder of this day to go through every individual circumstance and explain all the nuances. But the reality of it is, at the end of the day, no matter, maybe it was a moral failure, maybe it was a personal failure, maybe it was a failure in somebody else's life and it impacted a person or a family or a situation, or maybe a person just quit praying, or maybe a person never learned how to pray. It's myriad. But I want to tell you, there are no excuses and there are no reasons that would justify departing. In fact, I believe that what's taking place in this hour is I really do believe that God is trying to get our attention. But through the years, every once in a while, you will hear about some person or a situation or a family that decided to leave. They decided to depart from the faith. And I've often wondered when people leave that I genuinely felt like I was pastoring and they genuinely were allowing me to be the pastor, that there's a part of you that never gives up on that person. There's a part of you that always stands at the door with vigilance and always ready to extend mercy and grace and an opportunity to work with that person again. But through the years, oftentimes you will hear stories in which you're able to connect the dots of the pathway in which they chose when they departed from the faith. And there's one situation in particular where I had to make a determination because of a lack of repentance and a lack of personal accountability. Several years after this individual left our church, I saw their picture on Facebook. Somebody showed it to me, and I had no communication with this individual, and their hair was some bizarre shade of orange and just totally unrecognizable. If you would have pointed that person out to me and say, this is so-and-so, I would never have guessed it. I would never have been able to recognize that person. When you depart from the faith and there are spirits involved, and I'm going to tell you, make no mistake about it, the spirit world is convulsing. There is a extreme friction and unrest in the spirit world. And the souls of men are the currency of the spirit. It's a big deal. It's a big deal to make these kind of choices and decision to depart. But I want to encourage you, when you hear and you hear about the horrible stories about where people end up, and maybe, and it's very sad, and we don't approach this subject with glee or with any form of happiness, or we don't celebrate iniquity. But it's time for all men to repent. But when people knowingly, willingly depart from the faith, It should stand as a testimony that no good thing can ever happen by leaving God and leaving the church and leaving what you know and leaving the faith. This is what I believe God is doing in this hour, though, with all that's going on. The Bible says, wherefore he saith, awake, thou that sleepest. In my mind's eye, and I know that I'm greatly extrapolating and greatly using imagination here, but I can almost see that God is trying to wake us out of sleep. Wake up. Wake up. God is using the discomfort, the inconvenience, the overall confusion that's reverberating out of our culture, that's affecting schedules, affecting jobs, affecting livelihood. Wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Even people that are sitting on bar stools, people that are sitting on a couch, whose mind has become so clouded and cluttered by spiritual influence, by placing imaginations and personal goals and maybe fostering some bitterness against the church. I'll tell you, one of the things that we're seeing is that a huge uprising against authority, any authority. Where are they now? If you've been a student of these devotionals, you've seen over the last 4.5 months as I've been recording these morning devotions that I've asked several times, and I'm perplexed by this. I'm perplexed how that people that sat on pews and heard preaching and felt God's presence and saw miracles and saw the waves of the Spirit, people absolutely come out of incredibly disoriented and disgusting backgrounds, find repentance and find the gospel and find God and move forward in their lives. Where are these people? Where are they now? Many of them are lost in a dream. Wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Wherefore he saith, awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. There's always good news if we will wake up. God bless you. Thank you for joining us here this morning. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Thank you.